cloud will take too much time. Yeah, lots of time.
Okay, it is recording. Hare Krishna, nice. Prabhu Mataji. Can you see the screen, the PowerPoint slide I'm sharing?
Yes, we can see it.
Okay, thank you. So today's text is Bhagavad Gita 3.12. And of course, this is based on the teachings, whatever in ISKCON forum. Any program is always based on Srila Prabhupada's teaching. He is the preeminent Shiksha Guru. Shiksha means instruction, teachings. So whatever we are going to cover today, the basis, the platform is Prabhupada's teachings. And then of course, you know, different realizations and different learnings gathered from so many Vaishnavas in our own Sangha, Simeshwar Prabhu, Hema Jagannath Prabhu, yesterday Hari Kishore Prabhu, so many, our own Guru Maharajas, the other disciples of Srila Prabhupada. So whatever we hear, whatever we practice, you know, that's the basis of today's verse 3.12. So we'll start with Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Ishtan Bhogan Hivo Deva Dashyanti Yajna Bhavitah Tair Datan Pradayai Bhyo Yo Bhunte Stena Eva Saha. If you'd like, you can unmute your mics, and then we'll go line, call, and response. Line by line, we can do it. Ishtan bhogan hivo deva.
Ishtan bhogan hivo deva.
Dashyante yajna bhavitah.
Dashyante yajna bhavitah.
Tair datana pradayai bhyo.
Tair datana pradayai bhyo.
Yo bhunkte stena eva saha.
Yo bhunkte stena
eva. Very good. If some Prabhuji would like to try, don't feel shy. Even if you don't pronounce it properly, it's perfectly all right. Krishna looks at effort, not result. So if some Prabhuji would like to try, please go ahead.
Ishtan bhogan hivo deva.
Ishtan bhogan hivo deva.
Dashyante yajna bhavitah.
Dashyante yajna bhavitah.
Tair dattan apradayaibhyo.
Tair dattan
apradayaibhyo.
Yo bhunkte stena eva saha.
Yo bhunkte
stena eva saha. Mataji, anybody?
Istan bhogan hevo deva.
Ishtan bhogan hevo deva.
Dashyanti yajna bhavitah. Tairdattam apradya ebhyo.
Tairdattam apradaya ebhyo.
Yo bhunkte stena eva saha.
Yo bhunkte stena eva saha. Thank you. Very good. Synonyms. Translation and purport by His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada. Prabhupada Ji Ki Jai. Synonyms. Ishtan, desired. Bhogan, necessities of life. He, certainly. Vaha, unto you. Devaha, the demigods. Dashyante, will award. Yajna bhavitaha, being satisfied by the performance of sacrifices. Taeha, by them. datan, things given. Apradaya, without offering. Ebhyaha, to these demigods. Yah, he who, bhunkte, enjoys. Stena, thief. Eva, certainly. Saha, he. Translation. In charge of the various necessities of life, the demigods, being satisfied by the performance of yajna, sacrifice, will supply all necessities to you. But he who enjoys such gifts without offering them to the demigods in return is certainly a thief. Purport. The demigods are authorized supplying agents on behalf of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Vishnu. Therefore, they must be satisfied by the performance of prescribed yajna. In the Vedas, there are different kinds of yajna prescribed for different kinds of demigods, but all are ultimately offered to the Supreme Personality of Godhead. For one who cannot understand what the Personality of Godhead is, sacrifice to the demigods is recommended. There are certain texts which are highlighted in red and bold. So if you could please pay more focus on that. For one who cannot understand what the Personality of Godhead is, sacrifice to the demigods is recommended. According to the different material qualities of the persons concerned, different types of yajnas are recommended in the Vedas. Worship of different demigods is also on the same basis, namely according to different qualities. For example, the meat eaters are recommended to worship the goddess Kali, the ghastly form of material nature. And before the goddess, the sacrifice of animals is recommended. But for those who are in the mode of goodness, the transcendental worship of Vishnu is recommended. But ultimately, all yajnas are meant for gradual promotion to the transcendental position. For ordinary men, at least 5 yajnas, known as Pancha Maha Yajna, are necessary. One should know, however, that all the necessities of life that the human society requires are supplied by the demigod agents of the Lord. No one can manufacture anything. Take, for example, all the eatables of human society. These eatables include grains, fruits, vegetables, milk, sugar, etc., for the persons in the mode of goodness, and also eatables for non-vegetarians, like meat, none of which can be manufactured by men. Then again, take, for example, heat, light, water, air, etc., which are also necessities of life. None of them can be manufactured by the human society. Without the Supreme Lord, there can be no profuse sunlight, moonlight, rainfall, breeze, etc., without which no one can live. Obviously, a life is dependent on supplies from the Lord. Even on manufacturing enterprises, we require so many raw materials like metal, sulfur, mercury, manganese, and so on, and so many essentials, all of which are supplied by the agents of the Lord, with the purpose that we should make proper use of them to keep ourselves fit and healthy for the purpose of self-realization, leading to the ultimate goal of life, namely liberation, material struggle for existence. The aim of life is attained by performance of yajnas. The ultimate goal of life, namely liberation from the material struggle for existence. This aim of life is attained by performance of yajna. If we forget the purpose of human life and simply take supplies from the agents of the Lord for sense gratification and become more and more entangled in material existence, which is not the purpose of creation, certainly we become thieves, and therefore we are punished by the laws of material nature. A society of thieves can never be happy because they have no aim in life. The gross materialist thieves have no ultimate goal of life. They are simply directed to sense gratification, nor do they have any knowledge of how to perform yajna. Lord Chaitanya, however, inaugurated the earliest performance of yajna, namely the Sankirta Yajna, which can be performed by anyone in the world who accepts the principles of Krishna consciousness. Lord Chaitanya, however, inaugurated the easiest performance of yajna, namely the Sankirta Yajna, which can be performed by anyone in the world who accepts the principles of Krishna consciousness. Om Atyantimirandasya Gyananjana Shalakaya Chakshurunmilitam Yena Tasmai Shri Guruve Namaha Vanchakalpa Tarupyascha Kripasindhubhya Evacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Namom Vishnupadaya Krishna Prishthaya Putale Shrimati Bhaktivedanta Swaminiti Namine Namaste Saraswati Deve Gauravani Pracharane Nirvishesh Shunyavadi Paschatya Desha Tarane Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Srivasadi Gaura Bhakta Brinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare So Prabhu's Mataji's, you know, this purport is pretty much self-explanatory. So what we'll try to attempt is just go to a little bit more details, do some little extrapolation. Some of the stuff most of you would already be knowing, but it's a good idea to do a revision. Whenever we revise, as you know, it gets deeper into the memory. And once it's in our memory, we can always refer to it. And also it'll come handy when we are doing the practice of whatever we're learning. Right? Nyan. So today is Nyan part. And then whatever we learn, we can put it into action, and that is Vigyan, realization. So today's main points from this particular text is we'll try and examine what is yajna, basically sacrifice, the Sanskrit word for sacrifice, and then also this word demigod. The first time I heard the word demigod was when I read Srila Prabhupada's books. I think it may be the same case for most. We knew that there's God, and there was always the confusion, especially those born in the so-called Hindu families. There are so many gods to choose from. Is Ganesh God? Yes. Is Shiva God? Yes. Is Krishna God? Yes. Everyone is God. Correct? So then this term came, demigod. So who is demigod? We'll try and understand that demigod. So little bit of background to make things clear, and it would be as a reference point to the discussions we'll have in the coming slides. So we know there is Krishna, correct? Who is Krishna? Krishna is Ishwar Parama Krishna Satchitananda Vigraha. He is the Adi Purush, the original, the causeless cause of all causes. He is the energetic Shaktiman, source of all, the Para and Apara Shakti. Para we know are two types, correct? There's internal and the Tatastha, the marginal, correct? And then there is the external Bahiranga, the external energy, which is the material energy. Currently we are all in the material energy. He's also the absolute truth, and we know he's realized by the three realizations, the Brahman, his effulgence, impersonal, the localized aspect, the chit aspect, the Paramatma, and finally the highest source, the supreme person, correct? Bhagavan, the Ananda aspect. Sat, chit, anand. Sat is the Brahman eternality, existentialism. Chit is the omniscience, the knowledge, and Ananda, the bliss, the person. Ananda, if there is someone is Ananda, there has to be someone who enjoys that, correct? It's not just something abstract. If there's energy, there has to be energetic. So that is Krishna. Then we have these demigods, okay? Demigods are what we call the Devi Devtas. They are very much familiar with these terms, Devi, Devta. Devi is a female demigod. Devata is a male demigod. There are 33 crores, which is 330 million as per the metric system. Okay? They are nothing but like you and I. They are special people, empowered Jiva Shakti. Jiva Shakti is the Tatastha, the marginal energy. They are the marginal energies of Krishna. And keep in mind that they are all devotees of Krishna. They are not separate. They are all devotees of Krishna. And what they do, they are assigned to manage the universe under the direction of Krishna. So there is this universe. The demigods are placed in charge to manage the functioning of the universe. It's not that Krishna can't do it. Krishna creates just by his glance. Mahavishnu just glances, correct? And it impregnates. There is nothing that is impossible for Krishna. That word doesn't exist, impossible. If it's impossible, means he can't. Once someone asked Prabhupada, Prabhupada, can Krishna make something which is so heavy that he cannot lift? Now, this is like a trick question. So, Prabhupada said, yes. And the next minute, he'll be able to lift it. The next second, he'll be able to lift it. So, we think in terms of energy and capabilities, which is finite. But Krishna is infinite. So, he can make something which is so heavy that he himself cannot lift. Correct? And the next second, he'll be able to lift it because it's always increasing. His ananda is increasing. His opulences are increasing. There's no ant. He's unlimited. So these are the demigods, what we've understood. Then we have the jivas, correct? Demigods are also jivas, but let's talk about jivas as you, me, and everybody else, the ordinary jivas. Spirit soul, they are infinitesimal. Jivas could be either in the spiritual realm or in the material world. Material world, you know that there are these 14 levels, correct? Earth is somewhere in the middle. The higher planetary systems, where of course there is more facilities to enjoy. And then the lower planetary systems, where it's really a struggle. And it's very abominable type of living, the standard of living. Now the spirit souls are 8.4 million species. Now species are not just based on the, please understand, it's not just on the physical form, correct? It's also on the level of consciousness. In fact, in human beings, there are 400,000 species of human beings. From the degraded animal-like to very, very highly advanced, the consciousness, correct? And this species includes humans, animals, birds, trees, the aquatic, again, not just the form, but also based on the consciousness. Consciousness means the chit aspect, the awareness. And then of all these jivas, let's examine who the humans are. It's the highest form of jivas. So in these 8.4 million species that you see, you know, it's the lowest is the aquatics. Then you have the non-moving. Then you have the moving. Then you have the beasts. And then on top of them are the human beings. We have extremely developed consciousness, very developed consciousness. Typically, all the lower forms, they are in terms of the anna, maya, just for existence, for living. But human beings are even higher, okay, rational, what we talk about. Human is a rational being, the rationality. Now, with the human being is the species who could either be elevated or he could be demoted or he could be liberated. So understand, we're all caught up in this samsara, this material energy, external energy. And whatever the human being does, correct, he can either be elevated to a higher planet. So from Earth, perhaps he can even go to Brahmalok, depending on what we do, correct? Or again, whatever we do, we could go way down, Patala and all these other horrible places, okay? It is all dependent on karma, vikarma, or akarma. If you do akarma, you get liberated. And based on your karma, you could either be demoted or promoted. So this is the situation of us. This is the background. Keeping this background in mind, okay, let's understand who are demigods. You know, what is the identity? Unka pehchan kya hai? And then what are the functions, correct? Most of us have familiarity with quite a few popular demigods, as I mentioned. Lord Shiva, Brahma, we know Lord Ganesha, there's Kartikeya. People from South India, correct? They Swami Ayyappa, they call him. Kartikeya is there. So many demigods which are there. Especially if you go to a Tamil Brahmin's home and if you see in the temple, they have a huge chart and several of these demigods' photos are there and they'll worship everyone. They'll offer their aarti, everything. Basically, don't leave anyone out. Don't offend anybody. So there are these 33 crore demigods, okay? So a demigod who is a demigod, he's a human being like you and I. In fact, even Brahmaji is a demigod. Okay, a human being, correct? Yesterday, Prabhu was mentioning, if you do 100 horse sacrifices, Ashwamedha Yajna, properly, perfectly, okay, you could be elevated to the post of Indra. So all these positions, Brahma, Indra, etc., they are posts, correct? And there is a jiva occupying the post for that particular time period. It is not indefinite. That's why you see India, Indra is always in anxiety that someone will come and take my position away. So who are they? They are empowered people who are being empowered by Krishna. from whom he derives his power. He himself doesn't have any power. He gets it from Krishna, okay, to execute certain functions under the direction and control of Krishna. Now, why does Krishna engage them and he could do it all of itself? Simply because one of the nature of Krishna is to have engage in relationship with his jivas, correct? And secondly, and very importantly, why did Krishna just solve the Kurukshetra war just like that? Why did it have to go and fight for so many days? Over 2 weeks they fought, correct? Why was Arjuna made the hero? Because Krishna doesn't want to take any credit. He's also renunciation is one of his opulence. He wants his devotees to be glorified. He also tells Arjuna, right, boldly declare that my devotee will never perish. Boldly declare. He made Arjuna the center point of the whole Bhagavad Gita so that Arjuna's glory. And it's something like we also experience this. Someone praises us, okay. But someone praises a child, you get so much more joy. So they're all under the direction and control of the Supreme Being. So just look at it as, to give you an analogy, just look at it as a corporation. Krishna is the CEO. He's the 100% sole proprietor. These aren't shares where a board of director or some, you know, hostile takeover, someone else can come and take it. No. Whatever there is his. He's the sole proprietor. He's the CEO. Okay. Then there are his expansions and avatars, like, you know, people in his family. The expansions could either have 96% of his qualities. He has 64 qualities. So about 96% are the expansions, Baladev, Vishnu, Narayan, you know, these are the expansions. And then there are the avatars also. The avatars could be anywhere between 96% to 100%. So Krishna himself comes in Dwapar Yuga, correct? So he comes as himself, full Krishna. He also comes as Chaitanya Mahaprabhu in Kali Yuga. Very recently, about 500 odd years ago, he is no different than Krishna, 100% Krishna. So he comes as expansion and Krishna, and just look at it as like it's the same family, no difference, correct? And this entire existence which is there, just look at it as an organization. So here's the org chart. Krishna is the CEO, and then you have the main demigods. They are like the CXO function. In a corporation, you see you have the CFO, the chief marketing officer, the chief revenue officer, the chief technology officer, CIO, so many CXOs, correct? The main demigods. Who are the main demigods? The Shiva, who's known as Mahadev. The greatest of all the demigods is Shiva. And then you have Brahma. Brahma is in charge of the creation. And Shiva, incidentally, is not a Jiva. He's the only person, he's the only living entity who's between, you know, the between Krishna, the Absolute, okay, and the Jiva. He's somewhere in between over here, and he has about 84% of the qualities. So there are the main demigods. They have certain functions, Brahma and Shiva. Shiva is in charge of, you know, he does his thunder of the destruction, annihilation of the cosmos. And then you have these 33 crore Devi Devtas, okay? Just look at them as vice presidents, directors, managers, supervisors. Of course, a vice president is more powerful than the supervisor. So like this, there are different jivas with different function. There's a demigod who controls your eyelid, correct? So there is a demigod in charge of that. Now that demigod is much, much lower than compared to Brahma or Shiva. So Brahma and Shiva, you can more or less say they're on the same level. Vishnu comes, Guru Brahma, Guru Vishnu, Guru Deva, Maheshwara. Okay, Vishnu comes as the maintainer. So creation, maintenance, annihilation. Vishnu is Vishnu himself, Krishna. So these are the 33 crore demigods. Then you have example like Indra. I mentioned he's the king of heaven. He's in charge of rain. Ganesha, he removes obstacles. Okay. Vignesh, he removes all the obstacles which are there. Like there are so many other functions which the Devi Devtas have. A very good recommendation for studying and learning further if you want to understand who demigods are. And of course, this J I put in here a little bit is all of us, the ordinary jiva. We are under the control of the demigods. Okay. So recommended studies, if you go to Brahma Samhita, you know, take a minute to just go to ISKCON Desire Tree whenever you have the time /page/Brahma Samhita. There is the shlokas written which Lord Brahma has prayed, stuti to Lord Krishna, Govinda, and then the translation. So you read the translation and absorb that. You'll have a very clear understanding of who demigods are. Now, if we look at what is a yajna, sacrifice, right? Sacrifice is the act of giving up something which is dear to you or undertaking some austerity for a higher purpose in order to get something higher. Understand, it is giving up something dear to you, not something which you're not using. So, you know, that pastime, there was this guy who used to sell kurmura. Kurmura is called puffed rice, mamara. And every day, a brahmana would say, could you please make a small offering to the deity, Vishnu? No, next time you come tomorrow. You would keep pushing that person away. Then finally, one day, there was a huge breeze which came. And that mamra flew up in the air. Right? So what this fellow does, you know, being a vendor, very smartly, he said, hey, Vishnu, here's this offering for you. He really had no intention of doing it. But since anyway it's going, he said, let me get some benefit out of it, some profit like that. But no, that is not a yajna. That is, you have to do something dear for it. We also know in the Bible, Old Testament, where Abraham was actually going to sacrifice, God said to test him, sacrifice your son. His son is so dear to him. So he brought his son and he was actually going to sacrifice him with a sword. And then the Lord replaced with a goat over there. So, you know, in Islam, you have Bakri Eid. They sacrifice a goat. It is symbolic of that Abraham's intention. Like the Lord is so dear that he's willing to give up anything for the Lord. Also, another significance is that Prophet Muhammad, okay? Prophet Muhammad, who has been foretold, even Lord Jesus has been foretold in the Bhavishya Puran, okay? They're going to be great human beings who will come and bring people closer to God. At the time of Muhammad, there was a lot, I mean, human beings are just like animals. They would eat anything and everything. So what Muhammad says is, don't eat anything and everything. These are the animals which are prescribed for you. Eat only this. Don't eat everything else. And then it was, they're supposed to slaughter the animals themselves. And it's halal, which is slow. We think it is cruel. Correct? The animal suffers. But the philosophy behind that is that when you're cutting the goat's neck, you have to look in the eye and see its suffering. And perhaps it may touch your heart and you think like, what am I doing? So much so, even people who do the worship to Kali, of course, now it's not recommended at all, where they sacrifice the animal. You're supposed to whisper a mantra in the animal's ear. In this life, I'm taking your life. Next life, our roles will be reversed. So somewhere it may, you know, prick the conscience and it will say that, what am I doing? So that is the higher purpose. That's the meaning of sacrifice. So if you understand sacrifice, it is to elevate consciousness. That's the whole purpose, correct? And it is only for humans. Animals, there's no such thing as karma or sin. They only go ascending upwards. That is, they only get promoted till they come to the human form of life. So yajna sacrifice is prescribed for humans only. And it is based on time, place, and circumstance. We know that there are these four yugas, Satyug, the golden age, where people had 100,000 years days to live, long years and tremendous capacity, mental, emotional, intellectual capacity, long durations of lifetime, correct? Very in the sattvic mode there. And that time it was recommended to do meditation. They would be able to meditate for tens and thousands of years, okay? Here we can't even do one round properly. Why one round, even one mantra properly? Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Just to say these words, okay, how difficult it is. Here they would meditate for tens and thousands of years. That was for Satyug, that was the process. Then there is Treta Yug. Treta Yug is basically, there were the three avatars. We had Lord Narasimha Dev, Vaman Dev, Matsya Avatar. It's known as the Silver Age. So man's capabilities got a little bit diminished. 10,000 years was his lifespan. And then they were supposed to do great sacrifices is what they used to perform. You know, fantastic fire sacrifices with perfect pronunciation of the mantras and so on and so forth. That was the recommended process. In Dwapar Yug, known as the Copper Age, again, it started diminishing. Correct? In that age, it was temple worship the deities. And it used to be very elaborate, the temple worship. you know, the best of ingredients, the best of metals, the best of flowers, because those things were available then. And then finally in Kalyug, which is known as the Iron Age, okay, approximately human being lives for about 100 years. And then over here, the only process is chanting and hearing. Mahaprabhu came here specifically 500 years ago to do this. Actually, before that, and even some people do it even now, they practice what is called the Panchamaha Yajna. Srila Prabhupada mentioned it in the purport. What are these? It is daily ritual. And in fact, you know, if you go to my generation, okay, I'm in middle age now, but my grandmother, both my maternal, my nanima and my dadima, they both used to follow quite a few in our, when we used to live in a joint family, quite a few of these things used to be done. My mother says when my nanima and they all came as refugees from Pakistan during partition, very poor, literally no money, nothing, just as refugees. Still, whatever they used to get, my nanima used to make 9 chapatis. She used to make 9 chapatis, 2 of it to a sadhu, 2 of it to a poor man, 2 of it to a gaya, sorry, 7. 2 of it to a gaya and 1 to the crow, to gauma. And so much so, though it was very limited, what she would do, she would make normal size fulkas and offer it. And finally, for the children and whatever left is remaining, she used to make smaller size fulka because that was the observance that you have to do it. My great, my dadima, father's mother, I remember this, before eating, she used to go in the balcony. We used to live on the ground floor. She used to go in the balcony and call out, if anyone is hungry, please come. And if any beggar or someone passing by would come, and she would feed them first. So there is the pancha is one is Brahma, learning the scriptures, because we get the scriptures, what to do, what not to do, is we are paying a debt to the Rishi. If you remember the prophet Prabhupada says, there's nothing which is ours, nothing. All has been given by Krishna, and then there are different jivas who have put stuff together to make our lives easy now. Correct? So learning scripture is we pay the debt to the rishis. You have to read every day from the Vedas. Deva, the demigods, you do Homa, that you're paying the debts to the demigod. They're giving us rain, wind, so many things, correct? Pitri, our ancestors, we've got this body because of our father and mother, correct? We've been able, we're here today because of our father and mother. Of course, education, shelter, clothing, well-being, so many other things. You know, current parents of ours and then their parents, grandparents and so on and so forth. So Pinda, when we offer, it is doing debt, paying off the debt to the ancestors. Bhuta, other living entities, creatures, offering them food stuff. Okay. And then finally, service to humanity. We pay the debt to mankind. No one is alone. None of us is alone. We are all part and parcels and they're all connected to each other. Sometime back they did this, I think it's called 6th degree of separation. Literally, you will be able to know anyone else in the world. Anyone else anywhere in the world by just 6 degrees. So I know someone, my first circle of influence. And from that circle of influence, there's somebody else would know someone. So like this, if you make 6 circles, iterations, you can be able to connect it to somebody. So that they have found it even scientifically, 6 degrees of separation, they call it. So we are all connected. Everyone is interconnected and we all owe debt. There is nothing where we are debt-free. So mortgage and car loan and all is not the only. There are other debts, things that we have been using, consuming, which we take for granted. And Prabhupada says, if you don't pay your debt, what are you? You're a thief. It's not yours. You've been using it. You're a thief. Correct? So what this does is when you do the yajna, it develops all the good qualities, sympathy, mercy. It reduces all these anarthas. That sense of oneness is developed. Again, if you remember what is sacrifice and yajna, to develop a higher consciousness. And why do we need a higher consciousness? Because we are not supposed to be here. Our original position is Jivara Swarupa Nitya Krishna Das. We are from the spiritual world, Goloka. We are there. We've come over here. So it is to elevate us to that conscious level. And then we can say, oh, you know, I don't belong here, and start doing stuff which will take us back to Godhead. Another yajna for this particular age is called the Sankirta Yajna. Mahaprabhu came. Yesterday there was a nice discussion. Somebody asked on Mataji why he came as a hidden avatar. Correct? Prabhu gave such a nice answer. hidden avatar. His, of course, main reason why he's come is, there are three reasons. One is because he wants to understand, Krishna wants to understand what is there in me that Radharani is deriving so much bliss. What is it? What is it? What is it? So even Krishna, who knows everything, is kind of baffled by Radharani's love and devotion for him. Just see how devotion and love is. What devotion and love is. So he takes the form of a devotee. So he's nothing but Krishna in the mood of Radharani. And as a devotee, one of the main qualities of devotee is he never wants any praise. He doesn't want any pratishtha, you know, position, fame, glory, nothing. In fact, these words are like poison. It hurts. Tomorrow, if someone glorifies us, we like to, you know, our name. In my career, I've been in business development, and in early days of training in Tata, they used to say, when you meet with your prospect, always keep using his name. Call out his name, Mr. So-and-so here. Keep using his name in the conversation. People like to hear their own name. This is how our psyche has been conditioned, correct? It feels nice. Now, as the class is going on, Guru Maharaj is saying something, and Guru Maharaj looks at you, and then he says, oh, you know, Amritananda Das, how happy we feel. My name was called out from so many people sitting over here, correct? That is a conditioned state, but a real devotee, it hurts if he gets any praise or something. He will always direct it upwards. Why do we say all glories to Srila Prabhupada? All glories to Sri Guru and Gauranga. It's a practice. It's a practice so that we can be who we originally are. Humility. Correct? So here we have Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. That's why he came hidden. He didn't want to come as God. If he came as God, there would be awe and reverence. And the second is, he came to give love of God. Love of God is not cheap. It's so difficult. It's so difficult. He came and said, here, take. No qualification. You don't need any qualification to be chanting japa. Just take it. It's yours. The greatest treasure, he opened out. He opened the treasure house. There's a beautiful prayer by Lord Tukaram. Tukaram is a saint who was initiated by Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. It's Deha Tichidori. My Marathi is not very good. But Deha, this body, correct? And there is a safe, Tijori. He is in the safe. It's only meant for God. Come, please come and take it. And that love of God is Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came and he just gave it. But we are so conditioned. Whatever is free, they say, is not accepted, has no value. So the priceless gift, present it to us, and no value. People would look at Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and say, he's a madman. Someone would say, people would recognize, those who are realized would recognize Krishna. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is Krishna as God himself. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu would close his ears and he would say, please, please don't say that. So that was a couple of other reasons of his being hidden. So he's the one who came and gave this Sankirtan about great pity and mercy. He says, here, all you have to do is Sankirtan, correct? Chanting and hearing what it is. So what it is Sankirtan, it's a Yuga Dharma. We all know this verse, Hare Nam, Hare Nam, Eva Kevalam. So that is the Yuga Dharma. It's applicable for this age. Okay? Yuga Dharma, Sankirtan, the Mahamantra. 16, correct? Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. When you do this, everything is included. You don't have to do anything else. Literally, you don't have to do anything. That five rituals every day that you're supposed to do, all your debts, everything is paid. Not only your debts are paid, all the sins and conditioning, it's taken care of. Okay? So it's the Yuga Dharma. It's extremely easy. All you have to do is chant and hear, chant and hear, chant and hear. It's as simple as that. You could do it at any time, any place, no restrictions. In one class we discussed, even in the restroom, you could be chanting. And there are so many examples, correct? There is Jagannath Das Babaji used to go and chant outside a lavatory, municipal lavatory, because people would disturb him, come and Babaji, give me blessings and all. Blessings for all material things. I should get a good wife. you know, my daughter should get good husband, my business should do well, all the other material things. Okay, but the only condition is not anyhow. Currently, at least in my state, japa is being done anyhow. The idea is 16 rounds, you have taken a vow, so it has to finish. So the focus is on time, not on listening. And when the focus is on time, everything gets truncated. So Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare, becomes Hare Krishna, Ram. And then 16 rounds get over, the japa back comes down and heave a sigh of relief, it's done. Okay, so it's not anyhow. And what it does is, as we said, it's always there's a purpose, correct? To elevate consciousness. It's not just elevating, it's not promotion, it's not demotion, it's not even liberation. It's beyond that. It gives us love of God. It puts us back into where we were. Eternal associates of Krishna. Swarupa Siddhi. Maybe we are in Aishwarya. Maybe somebody is highly elevated in some other Vatsalya. Whatever be that, it will be revealed. So we are doing these processes. We are doing our sadhana. That's a yagya we are doing. We are doing the sacrifice. What are we sacrificing? We are sacrificing our sense gratification. Instead of sleeping, I get up. I don't want to get up. I get up. I sacrifice my enjoyment of sleep. I get up in the morning and I chant. Even imperfectly, Prabhupada said, it may be done imperfectly, but because we are following the perfect, our proposition is perfect. We may be imperfect. And Krishna doesn't see imperfections. If Krishna has to see imperfection forever, it is just stuck here only. Krishna sees what is your effort. One little step you take towards him, he'll take 100. In 3 steps, he covered everything as Vamandev. So this is what it is. The Sankirta Yajna. So that, Prabhu Mataji's, any questions that you have, we can answer it. There are about 5 minutes, 7 minutes. So question is a thought seeking the companionship of truth. So if you have any questions, please ask it. And here's Prabhupada deep in thought. What do you think Prabhupada is thinking? Of course, he said this, chant and be happy. 4 simple instruction words, 4 simple, chant and be happy. Why am I not happy? Chanting so many years, so many rounds. Anyone? What do you think Prabhupada is thinking? There are no right answers or wrong answers, incidentally. No one is answering. I'll have to follow in the footsteps of my dear friend Hari Kishore Prabhu and I'll have to call out on somebody.
Yeah, Prabhuji. So let me take a guess here. So this is thought provoking. So Srila Prabhupada, I'm sure he's, I am thinking that he's in thoughts of how can I expand this mission to get all the living entities, no matter the caste, creed, without any differences, back to Godhead. How can I expand this movement?
Maybe lovely. That is lovely. When I saw this picture, and yes, that is right. Now the question is, how can all... He built a house. He built a shelter that the whole world can live in, correct? Prabhupada built a house that the whole world can live in. The ISKCON movement, correct? What is he giving? He is distributing further whatever Mahaprabhu gave. Prabhupada is distributing it, wholesaler, here, come, take it. Correct? You don't need anything. So Prabhupada, when I saw this picture, I had, what it meant to me is Prabhupada is in Golok Vrindavan, correct? He's still thinking of you, me, and everybody else. And he's thinking, Prabhupada is thinking, you know, I've given them such a simple thing, chant and be happy. Now, if we can chant and we're happy, automatically it will attract everybody else. Automatically, it will attract everybody else. So the only key word, one small little word, operative word, Hari Kishore Prabhu, as you rightly said, what can be done to bring more and more people chant and be happy? Okay, the key word over there is
properly.
Thank you. Chant properly and be happy. Everything, all the knowledge, all the gyan, all the vigyan, everything will be revealed. And all it requires is a little effort on our end. Don't worry, we'll slip, we'll fall. We'll stand up, we'll fall again. Of course, there are all these support structures, association of Vaishnav, reading the books, everything. Deity worship. Just do that, chant properly. And of course, to chant properly, you have to be in Sangha. You have to serve. Okay, how do you serve? Right now, we only know each other at a first level. We see names on the Zoom call in temple. We see the face and the body. But we really don't know much about each other. We have no relation, to be honest, with each other. Maybe with a few. Ask the temple commander, Prabhu, how can I serve you? We chant Hare Krishna, asking for service. What is Hare Krishna? Hey, Radharani, please engage me in Krishna's loving service. Every day, 16 multiplied by 108. Those many times we are asking. But when the opportunity comes to serve, not that we are hungry and we want to grab to do service, we try to find some other way. So a person like a temple commander or a temple manager or whoever has some position of responsibility. So that, Prabhu Mataji, with that I bring it to a close. If you have any questions, we can take one quick question or we can post it on the Nityam Bhagavat Seva group. Srila Prabhupada ki jai.
Yeah.
Thank you and Hare Krishna.
Amritanand Prabhu, Hare Krishna.
Yes, Hari Bol Prabhu.
Yeah. you mentioned that in Dwapar Yuga, they used to do elaborate temple worship. And right now, with limited sources, resources, whatever, ISKCON and many other temples, they do also temple worship. So what you meant by elaborate, can you explain a little bit or can you throw lights or something?
Yeah, in that age, Prabhu, temple worship was the predominant. Each of these functions are the predominant function recommended for that particular time. Now, currently, the predominant function for Kali Yuga is, there are 9 processes, you know, of devotional service, correct? And out of this 9, the Shravanam Kirtanam is the prime. And actually, when we are doing Kirtanam, we are also doing Shravanam, right? Either you are doing Sankirtan or you are doing Japa. So today, when we are doing all the others are, you can look at it as the ancillary function to support this main, the dominant service. So we do deity worship. Why we do deity worship is so that we can develop an attachment with the deity. Deity is not stone. We read this in the book, Shastra. He is Bhagwan Swayam. We take darshan of deity. The deity is also taking darshan of us, is looking at us. Correct? When we offer bhoga to the deities, so what happens is we develop a relationship with the deity. And these things, what we learn in the scriptures, we start to get realization. Like Prabhuji gave that example of the Muslim tailor who makes the clothes for Shri Shri Radha Ras Bihari Ji. Every time he comes, new clothes, he comes and takes measurement. So someone asked him, why are you doing, you know, the deity, where is going to change? You and I, we become fat, thin, or whatever it is. So he says, no. They expand and, you know, now this person, now you may say he's not initiated or whatever, but look at his level of realization. He knows they are entities. They are living beings. They are the supreme living being. What we have on the altar is not marble. Lord Jagannath is not wood. He is Lord Jagannath. Govardhan Prabhu said in one of his classes, I don't want to go to Vrindavan or Mayapur or anywhere. For me, my Vrindavan and my Mayapur is over here, ISKCON of Central New Jersey. That's his level of realization. Why? Because he doesn't see them as stone. So the deities whom we worship is we can develop a relationship. Otherwise, it's all abstract. It's all intellectual. It's all mental. Krishna is a person. Right now, Krishna is sitting right beside us listening to this. Wherever his name is spoken, he's sitting there and watching. Can I see him? No. Premanjanan charita bhakti vilochanena santasadaiva hridayeshu vilokayanti yam shanta sundara achinta guna swarupam govindam adipurusham tamham bhajami. Do we have love in our eyes to see him? People say, show me God. So we have to see God through other processes or realize God. But once we start doing deity worship, our consciousness gets elevated, it gets transformed. That seed of love which is already there, that awakens, it starts growing. So deity worship in Kaliyuga is as a support function. In the Dwapar Yuga, it was the main function because people were capable. Their consciousness was still not that degraded. It was more degraded than Satya Yuga. So that's the answer, Prabhuji. Is it okay? Or maybe...
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Prabhuji. Hari Bol.
Mother Vaishnav can answer. I know Simeshwar Prabhu has another program. And there are meetings and bhakti vrikshas that Prabhuji does. Just see how much he is doing. What Simeshwar does. Whom he is doing it for? You and me. What is he getting out of it? It's not a paid job. He's juggling so many things. Prabhuji has dropped his child. Thousands of miles he has driven, coming back and forth. He's still thinking of, oh no, I have a responsibility for Bhagavad Gita class. I have a responsibility for Bhakti Vriksha, which he runs. I have a responsibility for the temple. He has different functions which he's handling. So if there is any level of gratitude, what I would humbly request is that ask a temple manager or a temple commander, you think things are just happening like this? Every day we see pictures of the deity. What lovely darshan. It just doesn't happen like that. There's a lot of behind the scene activities. Just ask Prabhuji, Mataji, what can I do to serve you? Then the relationships build up. And it's not that you're not doing it to help somebody. Please understand, service is to help ourselves. Whatever service you do, whether you're cleaning the bathroom or whether you're doing it on the altar. Of course, to go on the altar, you need Brahman, Diksha and other things. But you could bring flowers one day. The temple has some flower. If someone is not there, you could say that, fine, I can get the flowers. Physically, you can go. They have the order. One supplier is there. Go and bring it. You engaged in deity worship. Krishna is watching that. Fine. We are saying Hare Krishna. That can't be done. But let's boost up all these things with seva. Seva will help build relationships. Seva will help remove anarthas. Seva will bring about realizations. Thank you. Hare Krishna, Prabhu's Mataji. Thank you for your time.
Prabhuji, Hare Krishna. It's very, very wonderful class. And beautifully presented, you know, graphs, and it makes so much sense. I'm going to, you know, go through again with your class tomorrow. And I have heard everything what you just said and make so much sense with this graphs, and it make it easy to understand. And of course, the way you have narrated everything is so perfect and so nice. I really dandavat pranam to you, Prabhuji. It's very nice.
Thank you, Mataji, for your time. It's all the blessings of Vaishnavas, Guru Maharaj, Srila Prabhupada. Thank you.
Thank you, Prabhuji. Hare Krishna.
Thank you.
Evil.
Right. Wonderful.
Jai Shri Krishna.
Yeah. Thank you so much, Murugananda Prabhuji. Wonderful class. Yes, excellent. It was very nicely explained. Excellent. The basic points.
Thank you, Sameshwar Prabhu, for bringing this together.
Thank you, actually.
Shula very much indebted to you. Thank you.
Shula Prabhupada ki jai.
Yeah. Shula Prabhuji. Wonderful class.
Much of nice topics.
Bring it to a close.
Yes. Yeah, and if there are no other questions or comments or reflections, anybody else has anything to add? I mean, you can ask, you know, any, there is no specific that, okay, if you have some doubts or something to clarify, something you need to be more, you know, understand more, please ask. I mean, this is a very rare opportunity that, you know, that we are discussing Bhagavad Gita and topics of the Supreme Lord, spiritual topics, which are not ordinary, which are not mundane. It's good to discuss if you have, you know, if you have some realizations, it's, of course, I mean, please, you know, you can bring it up.
And, I'm sorry, Prabhuji. I just wanted to check, like, we were talking about the Kali Yuga, and we are talking about the Sankirtan Yajna, right? The chanting. Now, the other yajna, which used to be in the previous times, they're not recommended at all. Or, you know, if you want to do any yajna for that matter, should there not be encouraged only Sankirtana yajna, like Harinam only?
Yes, Prabhuji. First of all, we don't have the capabilities nor the resources to do the yajnas which were recommended for the previous ages, simply because A, our internal capacities, right? Intellectual, spiritual, is severely diminished. In fact, we are in the golden age of Kali Yuga. Golden age, it's called. There's going to be even worse. So if you read the scriptures, Bhavishya Puran and so on and so forth, what they foretell, and literally it's coming true, you can see it, that people will become cannibalistic. So much so, man will procreate for the sole purpose of filling his belly. And this is supposed to happen later on in Kali Yuga. It has happened recently, about maybe 10 years or so, in a very developed country, in a place called England, London. It was shocking, and it shook all the ethics, and people had to take a step back. And a lady, she gave birth to a child. And whenever there is birth, there is something called placenta. After the child comes out, there is that byproduct, the placenta, correct? You know what a placenta is. It's the covering.
I'm sorry, I understand where you're getting at. I just, in the interest of time, I was wondering, like, you know, in the temple, we have like little fire puja. I mean, you know, I see Prabhuji doing it, Madhupati Prabhuji does it at times. So those kind of, you know, pujas and those kind of...
That kind of puja is also recommended. Srila Prabhupada has recommended doing those. Those are called the fire sacrifices.
Yes. Correct?
And there are two aspects to those fire sacrifices. One is the pujari or the Vaishnav. Higher than even a Brahmana is a Vaishnav. The Vaishnav, his level of consciousness is elevated. So he's the person who's sitting there and performing these yajna. Narsingha Yajna for protection of everybody during these COVID times, Sameshwar Prabhu does it. Okay, Madhupati Prabhu does it. So these yajnas are for recommended, the person, number one, the person who's doing it, correct? His consciousness is highly elevated. He's also perfectly trained in that. If we go to the outside world, there are professional brahmanas and pandas who are just muttering shlokas after shlokas. Nobody knows what's going on, how it's going on. And it may not necessarily have the result. So it's consciousness based. And again, it is as a support function. The primary is Sankirtan.
Right.
Then we have deep worship and then the yajna and so on and so forth, which is the support function. Then it's also very important as to who's doing the yajna. There are people who come and, you know, I've seen marriage ceremonies. Literally, if you talk to any panda and you say, I have this particular difficulty, no problem. He'll find an upai for it. You say, nahi, nahi, mera aisa nahi hoga, mere se aisa, no problem. He'll do some jugaad, he'll do some kind of an adjustment and got it done. But with a Vaishnav, to do, Vaishnav won't do that. He'll do whatever is required. So that training, and more importantly, is his consciousness. So the person sitting there for the sacrifice is even higher than a Brahmana, is even higher than a Pujari. And he won't do the shortcuts and all this other. He's not in it for money. It's not his source of income. It's his source of magnanimity. Does that answer? Or maybe Simeshwar Prabhu, who is the...
Yes, Prabhuji. I mean, I understand from a support standpoint, yes, it could be supplemented. Yeah. That's my take also. But primary should be the Japa, Naam, Sankirtan. Thank you.
Yes, that's correct, Prabhuji. Mardanda Prabhu, you said it correctly. The primary, that's the recommendations. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Srila Prabhupada. Chant the holy name, perform the Sankirtan, that's good enough. It has everything. Lord is invested all his potencies. Nam Namakari Nicha Sarva Shakti. All potencies are invested into the holy name. One who takes the holy name, that's good enough. But we should always remember that we have impediments. So these puja, these ajñas are actually to remove those impediments or those obstacles in our path of bhakti. So we pray to Lord Narasimhadev that please remove all the impediments in the path of bhakti so that we can focus more. That's our prayer. Even some devotees may worship demigods. Even Srila Prabhupada mentioned that you can keep Lord Ganesha, offer Lord Ganesha. So, but condition is that you worship so that Lord Ganesha can remove the obstacles in the path of bhakti. So these all ajñas are doing, not for money, not for fame or anything like that. This is Vaishnava homas. These Vaishnava homas, purely offering to Lord Narasimhadev. Even these rituals are different than the karmic, fire sacrifices. Instead of worshipping demigods, this Vaishnava Yajna is actually worshipping the Vaishnavas, Gurus and Vaishnavas. Since it's asked, Prabhuji mentioned that even spiritual master is considered as the even goes beyond the position of the demigods, even a spiritual master. And sum total of all the demigods, even this spiritual master surpasses those positions. Instead of demigods, this puja, mainly yajñas are actually mainly to please the demigods, but these Vaishnava homas are not in that sense, but instead of demigods, the yajna is actually for the spiritual master. And of course, Vaishnava Homa is actually an offering to the spiritual masters and, Param Guru, Param Param Guru likes that. Then Vaishnava, of course, the Supreme Lord Sri Krishna. And mainly for to remove the impediments so that devotees can sit. Like for example, we do this for the COVID. So the main reason for doing this yajna for, to remove, to fit or the physical health so that they can situate, nicely in the service of the Supreme Lord. It's not that, for any personal benefit, but further for the service of the Supreme Lord. So that is the intention, nothing else. Thank you. Yes,
wonderful. Thank you.
Clarify. Anybody else? Okay, if there is nothing else, then let's conclude. Thank you so much for joining today. We would humbly request all of you, please join this wonderful association of devotees. We all can benefit in many ways. There's no words to express that. Thank you so much. So let's pay our obeisances to all the Vaishnava devotees of the Lord. Vancha kalpatarupasya
kalpatarubhyascha
kripasindhubhyo
vaishnavebhyo
vaishnavandhi
jaya.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Prabhuji. Hare Krishna.
Thank you, Prabhuji.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.